Saint Joseph Maria Escrifa is a Catholic priest, but I don't think there's a priest around here, so it's quite sure that this is not a Christian sort of dominated institution. We have very strong Christian values. We accept people across the board, and we respect those foundation values. The founder told us, you have to work 100% as everything depended on what you do. But at the same time, you have to pray with an R, because you know, you have to pray as if everything depended on your prayers. So you win both sides. And I think, again, this is something that I pick from that quote, that there is a strong understanding that we can do as much, and something else, we have to go down on our knees and ask for forgiveness. So this is our principle, and I think we share that in common. Having said that, I think you'll now join me in welcoming our chief guest, Mr. Tony Erumeu, MFR, Chairman Hearst Holdings Limited, and a who is also the founder and trustee of the Tony Erumeu Foundation. Put the hands together for Chief.
I'd like to thank the Dean of Strathmore Business School, the faculty members, elders of this country who are here, senior business leaders, fellow entrepreneurs, students, and my colleagues. I am honored to be here with you this morning and to have the opportunity to share my thoughts on this very interesting topic. Interesting because, to me, I believe that, as this institution does, Africa, to a large extent, can and will be developed by the private sector. Government has a role to play, but the role of government, to a large extent, is to help facilitate or to help create the right environment. But it is when we begin to see the emergence of African multinationals that can employ people, help to grow our economies, that we will say that the age of Africa has truly come. So to choose this topic, I think it underscores to a large extent this belief that I have, and the one that this school shares, and the one that I think most people who are in this hall today equally agree with. Otherwise, the hall will be as full as it is this morning. In approaching this topic, I have tried to, as much as possible, to simplify it. I have 1 hour, so I try to speak for like 30 minutes and take comments, questions, so that we make it fairly more practical. So what I'm going to speak today is largely from experience. And I've chosen to tell a story. So I shall tell a story. And after telling the story, I've tried to extract the learning points from the story. Then I will proceed to draw a few conclusions and leave us with two parting shots at the end. Now, the story I've chosen is a story about an institution I have been associated with, one that also operates in this country. We're talking about building Pan-African businesses, or building Africa-wide cooperation. So I've chosen the case of United Bank for Africa, UBA. UBA, why did I choose UBA? Beyond the fact that I have been associated with the institution, and it makes it easier for me to tell the story that I know, is that depending or irrespective of how you want to define an African multinational African corporation or African white corporation, UBA would pass the test. As the chairman of UBA Kenya said not long ago, UBA operates in 20 African countries. So if you define by geography, it means UBA is actually multinational. In terms of size, it's significant. In terms of industry of play, financial services is key to economic development of most countries. So I've decided to use the story of UBA in approaching this discussion this morning. Now, the story starts. And please, Uba, you're my timekeeper. 30 minutes to tell this. We, in 1997, some of us decided to acquire a distressed bank. You know, financially, when a bank is distressed, it means it's short to public. You don't have customers go to the bank. The bank is no longer in clearing. The bank, in fact, completely shut down. So we acquired a bank, a commercial bank, that was distressed, and commenced the journey for turning around the distressed bank. At the time, it had just 5 branches, and we had ideas. And it's good to share this story. Bansandi School has Business Incubation Center. We had ideas, but we didn't have all the money we needed. So we did, at the time, what is called today debt equity swap. And through this program, we were able to acquire the bank. What do I mean? The bank had depositors they owed. And so we approached the depositors and got them to convert their deposit to equity. Some converted and kept in their name. Some converted and said no. Some said no. We have confidence in this group. If you can take over our liabilities or this bank's liability exposure to us and pay us over a period of 2-3 years, we're fine. But we do not want to. Our deposit, keep in view that we're going to lose the deposits. We don't want to leave our deposit at this bank. So through these schemes, we're able to acquire significant interest in the bank and we commenced the journey. But first thing we did in this journey of a distressed financial institution in 1997 that today is UBA operating in 20 African countries presence, and by the way, UBA is the only African bank that is operated out that operates in New York, in US, and registered and funded. So we, first thing we did was to have a retreat where we sat together to craft the strategy and the vision for this new organization and how, where we want to be, how we're going to get to where we want to be, which kind of customers we want to serve, what value proposition do we offer to these customers, and on and on. We were about less than 100 at the time. We sat and we came up with what we called a 3-tier strategic intent for the name of the bank at the time, Standard Trust Bank, not UBA. And so we met, agreed. So the 1st-tier strategic intent for us was we want in 10 years' time to become one of the top 3 banks in Nigeria. And after that, we want to become, the biggest commercial bank in Nigeria. And after that, we want to be a key player in the African financial services industry. Keep in view, this was a distressed bank. And so it talks about the power of vision. We created the 3-tier intent and everyone understood it clearly. So there was alignment of interest and also everyone was quite clear about what we wanted to be and we put time periods to this. Next thing we did was to engage a few more key staff to support the process. And from 5 branches, under the period of 7 years, we have grown the bank to 100 branches and became the first bank in the country to be integrated online retirement with IT. So you can enter any branch, the first bank with the highest brand network, 100 branches that were integrated online retirement. You can enter any branch of Standard Trust Bank and transact across the country. And things started changing. So we had a second retreat. I said, okay. The first year intent was to become one of the top 3 banks. At this time, we had become top 5, one of the top 5 banks. So we had the second retreat to revalidate and see, should we change our tier 2 vision or are we still on course? We decided that we should revalidate it and continue along the same line. So we then decided that to move from top 5 to number 1, we need to do some transactions by way of acquisition or combination. So between this period, we raised capital from the market 2 times. So you need, in banking business, you need a lot of capital to do transactions. So we moved, and in 2003, we started exploring the possibility of merging with one of the top 3 banks in the country so that we can leapfrog or acquire. But then small bank acquiring big bank was a bit tough. However, in 2004, we concluded a transaction where the 5th biggest bank in the country, Standard Trust Bank, that we were running at the time, and the 3rd biggest bank in the country, United Bank of Africa, came together. But as you know, in all mergers, there's almost always an acquisition. So Standard Trust had acquired strategic interest, about 33% of UBA, then merged. And that was how, in 2005, the merger occurred. And we automatically became the number one bank in the country. And we had to deal with the issue of integration, mergers. And by the way, that was when I met Mr. Kunon's son, who was working for McKinsey at the time. I was one of the people that came to Lagos to help consummate the transaction. So we built this. At this time, 2005, UBA had 428 branches across the country. And we said, okay, we want to be the leading bank in the country, and with some margin between us and the next bank. So we defined the parameters again, deposits, brand network, customer base, ATM, etc., profitability. And we crafted our intent. I said, okay, number one in Nigeria, first year. 2, one, a Pan-African bank, one of the leading banks in Africa, and 3, an African bank with global presence. Again, we started this journey. So the first one, within a period of under 4 years, we had developed or grown the branch network to 700 branches across the country. We had fully integrated the bank. We had ATM machines in excess of 3,000 across the country. We had rapidly grown our customer base. And we're offering good products to our customers. But the second tier intent, growing a Pan-African bank, was yet to start. So we commenced the journey, and within a period of 5 years, we were able to grow the new UBA into becoming a Pan-African bank with presence today in 20 countries, including Kenya, across Africa. This is the small journey or story of an African institution that has grown from a one-country institution to a Pan-African one. In 2010, BCG, the Boston Consulting Group, did a study on what they call, I think, the African champions, or the African line, African champions. And they came up with about 40 champions across Africa. And UBA and Dangote Group were two Pan-African institutions that emerged from Nigeria. For those who read the report here, most of the institutions came from North Africa and South Africa. But UBA became one of those countries. And one of the criteria they used was this issue of size and also the spread of UBA across Africa. Today, that Pan-African ambition that UBA had is a reality. And there's a third intent, which is to have presence in global financial centers. So today, UBA is in New York, UBA is in London, and UBA is in Paris. So, and beyond all of this is the fact that UBA is able to, today, has close to 25,000 Africans on its as staff of the bank, and plays a key role in growing, supporting economic transactions in these countries, helps to achieve financial inclusion for these countries and these economies, helps to create a payment platform that helps people within Africa and these countries to move money from one place to the other, and has helped in so many other ways that are not even directly related to banking. For instance, in Kenya, thanks to the leadership here, I think it was through efforts of institutions like UBA that a Nigerian, for instance, can fly into Kenya and get visa at the airport. And so what I'm saying all of this is the beauty of growing Pan-African institutions. There's so much for Africa to gain. And there's need for most of us to see beyond the shores of our home country when we're discussing thinking of growing businesses. But let me read this story and talk about the learning points from this, because that is what where we begin to connect the dots. So, the learning points. One, it's good when you want to create, if you want to create a Pan-African institution, to have a vision. You know, for us, it started with a vision. And part of that vision was where we saw beyond the shores of our home market. We saw Africa as our market. So for business leaders here who are interested in creating a Pan-African institution, an African-wide cooperation, go back a bit if you've not drawn or come up with a clear vision that encompasses this aspiration. Put one in place and get the people who work with you, your key listeners, to buy into it. Debate it. Ask yourself, because there are also challenges I've talked about in growing a Pan-African institution. At times, people will want to say, let's just remain within the confines, within our own geography. There's no need going further. But there's also beauty in diversifying the earning geography of the geography of your earnings. Second lesson is develop your strategy for making your vision happen, for serving the customers you want to serve. So for instance, when we started our Standard Trust Bank, because this was a distressed institution, and based on our reading and understanding of the market at the time, we wanted to serve the mass market. Not bottom of the pyramid math, but wanted to be a retail and commercial bank. And so we did certain, we came up with certain ideas, innovation to enable us to achieve this. That was why, for instance, we were able to link all our branches online retail. And with that, we changed the structure of our business significantly. Because first, we allow people who were customers of Standard Trust Bank to transact, come in to the branch and transfer money to their children who were schooling elsewhere. But later we open it up. So you don't even have to be a customer of Standard Trust Bank for this to happen. And that just almost destroyed the real competition. So it's good to have first, where do I want to go? The destination. How do I play to achieve this? Very important. The third point is you need capital to roll out business, to do a Pan-African business. You need money. At times you might be lucky to have your own money. If you're not lucky to have your own money, I believe from my own experience, most of the so-called advanced capital raising techniques you have abroad, they do work here. We did an acquisition and sell through a debt equity arrangement. We did IPO, we IPO'd the bank, they did initial public offering, and the DG of STEC is here, so I'm sure she'll be happy to support if we want to do so here. We did this first time, second, even to acquire UBA, we had to raise money again from our shareholder, but our shareholders were happy because we paid dividends, we grew value for our shareholders. And so, you need to think about capital. At times, I don't support the idea of people using debt, just go and borrow money from bank to expand. You could do that, but you also need the right mix and combination. Otherwise, the interest burden could actually affect your ability to achieve your objective. Because as you see, as I will share with you, the waiting time for internationalization within the region is long, or can be long. Next is human capital. You know, I would say that one of the key reasons for the success that we achieved so far is the fact that human capital was very truly important to us. And let me explain this. But by the way, up until I left UBA, I had HR.